Hey guys, welcome to part 3 of my Leopard 2A7 build in 1/35th scale by Meng. What I'm going to do today is actually paint this beast, and pretty sure this is going to end up being either a 2 or 3 part painting series just because of how much there is to be done on this. What I'm hoping to do today is get the camouflage coated, or based rather, and start working on some of the oil washes, so that I can let it dry over a couple of days or until next week and then go from there. So just a couple of things to go over before I get going on this. What I'll be using are the Meng paints, or the, I'm sorry, the AK paints, the main color that were specifically for this kit. I'll be base coating it with some NATO green, followed by whatever the camouflage colors are. As you can see, I undercoated it black. I use regular Vallejo airbrush primer. Works well. I know a lot of people complain about it. Works well for me. I've never had any problems with it. Just have to let it dry a little bit longer. I usually leave these things for at least 48 to even up to a week, 48 hours up to a week even, to let it dry before I do anything to it. I sanded these before and works fine for me as long as you let it dry for the appropriate amount of time. Other than that, yeah, so the first thing I'm going to do is get this thing base coated with the green. I will be freehanding the camo on it. I really don't feel like messing around with any sort of masking or anything like that for the camo. And I'll be following the guide and the instructions as far as the patterns and stuff. Other than that, the airbrush I use are the Badger airbrushes. I've never had any issues with these whatsoever. I love these things compared to you know, a lot of guys use the Iwata or the hardened steamback ones, which are a lot more expensive than these. These I get for about $100 a pop, and they've actually been very good airbrushes to me. So I have 3 of these now, and they all work superbly. But other than that, yeah, let's get started on this. Thank you. Alright guys, so I'm all set with the camo. And these actually let this sit overnight. I did the camo last night. As you saw, I did it all freehand. I didn't use any masks or anything like that. There are a few areas I'm going to touch up on this. Hopefully you can see it well enough. So for instance, I'm not sure how well it's showing through. There's a couple of stains over here that didn't dry the way I'd like it to dry. It's a little shiny in some places. So what I'm going to do next, and there's also some areas, there goes my phone, there's also some areas that I missed completely. So what I'm going to end up doing next is taking a brush and going over some of these areas with my brush to fill in the edges, as well as to harden it up a little bit. The edges, obviously being airbrushed, are a little soft. The actual camo on the leopards is quote-unquote harder camo. So what I'll do is I'll go through some of these areas and harden up the camo, the lines around here, basically, just to make it look a little bit more realistic. Now, I wasn't too peculiar or too particular about how close to the actual scheme on the tank I did. I made it. Just because I think this looks good as is. And I didn't really want to waste, or not waste, but I didn't really want to devote that much time into making it perfect. I think it looks good the way it is. What I'm going to end up doing, as I said now, after I harden it up a little bit and fix it up a little bit, I'm going to do some edge highlights on here, on the tank itself, on the hard edges. I'm going to paint all the details, such as the MG up here, the tools, the tow cables, antenna, etc. There's a cat here on here, that's not good. It's always with two cats in the house, always any model I build, any figure I paint, there's always going to be at least a couple of cat hairs on there. So anyways, what I'm going to end up doing is, the plan for tonight at least, is to harden up this camo, paint the tools, cables, grenade launchers, etc. Paint the wheels, the tires on the wheels, and then seal it all with gloss varnish to prep it for decals and washes and weathering in general. The gloss varnish I like to leave to dry overnight at least till tomorrow evening. So that's why I want to get that done today, so I can come home from work tomorrow and get going on the washes. Now tomorrow's plan is going to be a pin wash, and there's a cat in the video. Let me get the cat out of here. Apologize for that. But yeah, so I'm going to get started on the tools, also the periscopes, the hatch periscopes, the screen periscope over here, and the driver periscopes. I did not mask because I was planning on painting them to begin with. So that's another thing I'm going to paint tonight before everything gets a coat of gloss varnish. So I'm going to get started, and let's see what damage we can do to this thing tonight. So the goal here, as I mentioned, is basically to sharpen some of this camo up and fix some of it up by basically applying the main camo colors via brush. So natal black, natal brown, natal green. Essentially, the brushes I use are the Winsor & Newton Series 7s. Sorry. They're a little bit more expensive. They're Kolinsky Sable brushes, around $15 a brush. They hold their tip very well. I like the paint reservoirs on them. Used to using these for figure painting, so I just kind of use the same brushes for detail painting when I'm painting my models. You can get away with something a lot cheaper, something, you know, synthetic or otherwise, but I'm just used to using these, so that's why I ended up just continuing to use these on models along with figures. Use a little plastic plate for my palette. I usually use a wet palette when I'm painting figures or when I'm painting more extensively with the brush, either, you know, for blending or whatever else I need, but for today's purposes, for all I need to do, I'm just going to use the plate. It's a lot easier. It's less of a hassle. Now, as I mentioned, the goal is to sharpen these things up, but I don't want to sharpen them too much. So, what I'm going to end up doing is I put a little bit, not a little bit, but I put whatever I need for paint. This helps a little bit. Whatever I need for paint on my plate here, which isn't very much. And then what I'll end up doing is adding a drop of Vallejo glaze medium. Now what this does is makes the paint a little bit more opaque. When I say I want to sharpen it up a little bit, I should take it off my brush, that's enough. I say I want to sharpen it up a little bit, yes I do, but not enough to where you can see that it's clearly painted by brush. So hopefully I can get to that happy medium by adding the glaze medium on there. I'm going from there. This is probably going to take a few coats to get the right appearance. But this is essentially what I'll be doing throughout the entire model here with this. Especially the brown paint, that's the most problematic one, just because it's the lightest, so it covers, its coverage is the thinnest, I guess, for lack of a better explanation. Again, I'm not using the reference anymore in the instruction book, just because at this point it's basically just going through whatever, or making it look good for me, not necessarily keeping true to the actual cam. Tend to be a bit of a rivet counter for a lot of things, but when it comes to painting the actual subject as opposed to the assembly, when it comes to painting the actual subject, it's more of a what looks good as opposed to what looks realistic, as you'll see by the time we're done with this, hopefully, is I go a lot more for... This is what I'm trying to achieve here. See this stronger line here between the camo colors? That's what I'm trying to achieve, so this will actually do well. I'm a lot less of a rivet counter as far as colors than I am during the assembly of the model. I go for more of what looks good as opposed to what looks realistic. You'll see, at least hopefully this will translate to, I tend to use more contrast as far as sharper highlighting, deeper shadows, etc. on my models. I just feel like at 1/35th scale, you're not looking at the real thing, you know, you're looking at a good representation of it, but it's a representation that also aesthetically needs to look good. And what we may find, or at least in my opinion, what we find aesthetically appealing in 1/35th scale differs from the real thing. So I'm definitely gonna definitely go more for aesthetic appeal as opposed to realism. If I can pull both off, then of course, but I'll definitely go for the aesthetic appeal first before I go for the realism. Now this is essentially what I'm going to end up doing on the whole tank and all three colors. I'm not going to bore you guys through the entire, well, I am going to bore you guys through the entire process, but what I'll do is I'll speed it up and shut my trap so you guys don't actually have to endure listening to me ramble on talking about this, but I hope you at least get the gist of what I'm doing here. Hopefully you can see it. Flip around real quick. Hopefully you guys can see this. As you can see, it's much starker transitions here between the camo colors, as opposed to if I just left them with the airbrush, what the airbrush accomplished, and that's my goal here, to make it look a little starker, just because that's how the real tank patterns look. But other than that, that's what I'm going to continue on throughout this whole thing. So enjoy whatever whatever horrible drabby music I decide to play for you guys. I'm gonna get my glove on here, so I'll touch the paint with my hands. Now, some of you guys may have noticed already, I do wear a plastic glove to handle my models, especially once they're painted, once they're coated. We all have natural oils on our hands, and last thing I want is to get any of that natural oil onto the model, or try and get as little as possible at least. So that's why I wear my gloves. Or at least one glove when I'm brush painting, obviously I don't need two. But yeah, this is what I'm going to end up doing throughout the entire thing here. Now, places like these, I think I'm going to leave some of the transition here. Now also keep in mind, this is a texture. The plastic is textured, obviously. It's got the anti-skid texture on here on most of it. On most of the turret. Or even if it's... Is it the anti-skid? No, it's just texture. I'm sorry. It's just textured cast to replicate the actual hull texture, obviously. So the paint is not going to spread as easily as it would on something that's a much flatter surface, which makes it a lot easier to overload the surface with paint, thinking that it's okay. But remember, the more paint you pile on here, the more stark the transitions between the camo will be. That said, that is what I'm going for, obviously, to make them a little bit more stark, but you don't want them too obvious either, because that's another thing. Also, be careful which way your brush strokes go. You want to go with kind of the direction of the plate, if that makes sense, or of whatever angle you're painting. Kind of want to keep one direction also of your strokes, of your paint strokes, only because... Let's see if we can zoom in a little bit here. Yeah, there we go. Only because, again, if your strokes are too aggressive or if you overload your brush with paint, if your paint is too thick, the strokes will be visible, and then that'll take away from the whole purpose of me airbrushing this to begin with, to make the transitions a little bit more seamless. That said, also, yeah, be careful. I know this paint is good to use out of the bottle for airbrushing, like I did when you guys saw me airbrushing it last night. I used it straight out of the bottle. I did not use any thinner with this paint. It's awesome out of the bottle, but when you're brush painting, you always want to water it down more so than just out of the bottle, because that also prevents any brush strokes being visible. The one place I really want to pay attention to are the grenade launchers here, just because of the geometry of these pieces. It's a lot harder to... Or it's a lot easier to miss a spot with the airbrush. So I just want to kind of go into the crevices here, nooks and crannies, and fill in everything. Now, you will notice my brush is starting to fray a little bit. This is not a brand new Winsor & Newton brush. I save those for the figure painting, if I want to actually need them. A brand new brush, or this is a brush that I've been using for a while and will use for base coats on figures and things such as this, where I don't necessarily need a perfect sharp point on my brush for a detail painting of any sorts. But yeah, so this is what I'm going to continue doing all around here, filling everything in, then the hole for all three colors, and then we'll go from there. So let's see how long this takes. Hopefully it won't take too long, because I do have a lot I want to get done on this tonight. So hopefully this stage or this process won't take too long, but if it does, oh well. I feel like it'll look a lot better. And I'll go from there. Also, one other thing, if you guys do choose to try this, don't worry too much if you happen to, let's say, like if you feel like this line that I just made right here, can you guys see this? Yeah. Okay, if you feel like this line that I just made right here, if this happens to you, is a little too stark, don't worry too much, because what I'll end up doing later on is applying a lot of oil washes, a lot of oil filters to this. So a good portion of this hard edge camo will actually blend in a little bit more, and that's another reason why I'm trying to harden the edges a little bit here as I go, is because a lot of this will be naturally, or not naturally, but blending itself even more with the application of oils, etc. And another thing is, again, I just use this as an excuse to cover up parts that I've missed that should have camo on. And now that's not a huge deal. Weathering covers up all sorts of sins on scale armor or on scale anything. So it's not a huge deal if you miss something, or if you don't cover it 100%, weathering will usually take care of that, or you can weather that area by choice to make sure it takes care of that. But yeah, I'm just gonna continue on with this, and I'll come back to you guys, or I'll talk to you guys when I'm done with this and proceeding to the next step. Actually, finally, before I do turn the music on, is another thing that this does is my airbrush was acting up yesterday. I think I had the humidifier going yesterday for my fiance, so I think what ended up happening was some of that moisture got into the air hose, and the moisture trap didn't actually capture as much as I would have hoped. So there's a few blotches of discolored paint. I don't know how well you guys can see this on here. So for instance, this green area here is a little shinier than this matte area here, and so on and so forth here. I don't know if that was me applying it a little thicker, or whether it was the humidity or what it was. Anyways, what this is doing is hopefully amending those issues as well. So that's another reason why I went ahead and did that. But yeah, that's pretty much the trick to it. Pretty much, there's no real technique to it. You just have to be patient, have to be careful of what you're doing. And again, if you make mistakes, no biggie. It's paint. It'll cover up. It'll come off just as it went on. So don't be afraid to get your hands dirty and really get in here if you'd like to give it a go. Brush painting really isn't that scary. It's really not some lost art here, so I know it can be a little daunting, especially on camouflage and on bigger surfaces, but it's really not that big of a deal, so you guys feel free to give this a try. Anyways, I've rambled on enough. Enjoy whatever horrible music I've decided to play. And talk to you guys in a few. Thank you. Alright guys, so what you just saw me do is go over all the camouflage with a brush and make it a little starker, make the transitions a little starker on here. It took a lot longer than I thought I would, because what I had to end up doing was actually going over most of the camo areas just so that it blends in and that one or the edges don't look darker than the rest of the camo. So it took a lot longer than I thought it would. So it is now the next day, because all I did yesterday was just the camo. So it is now the next day, and what I'm going to attempt to do today is the edge highlights on the along a lot of the edges on the tank here. I was fooling around with the idea of using three different colors on the edge highlights, depending on what I'm highlighting, whether it's the black, green, or the tan. I think I'm going to forego that idea, though, because I feel like that would look a little too washy. They're a little too washed out, I guess, or a little too stark, even, in areas. So I think what I'm going to end up doing is just using one color everywhere. That being a bone or a off-white color. What I'll end up using is Vallejo Ivory. For these, I'm going to water it down quite a bit, and it's literally going to be just the thinnest line around edges here, on pronounced edges on different features on the tank here, just to make it pop a little bit more. After that, what I'm going to end up doing is painting the tools, accessories, lights, periscopes, any displays, any screens, anything like that. The machine gun, grenade launchers, smoke launcher covers on here, and painting all that hopefully tonight. Although it might go into tomorrow, depending on how quickly I move over here on this. I may very well actually drag into tomorrow, who knows. But for the time being, that's the plan at least. I'll see how it goes. So I'm going to get started here. Put the turret on the side for the time being. I'm going to get started here and see how this goes. guys noticed, what I started out doing was doing the actual edge highlighting here with my Winsor & Newton brush with just a controlled paint just like this here. But what I decided was that it was going to take way too long, so I opted for a much quicker, much easier kind of sort of controlled dry brush on these. Only because I really didn't want to put all of today or all of tonight into something that will more or less not be seen as much as I'd like it to be for that kind of time commitment. So I just wasn't prepared to commit that amount of time into something that's pretty much not going to disappear, but it's definitely going to be toned down quite a bit once I get the once I get all the washes and stuff on here. So before I move on to painting the tools and the accessories and everything else, I am going to highlight some of the top portions or some of the high points on the model here so they pop a little bit more. The way I'm going to do that is I'm going to take my three base colors and mix them in with a little bit of Vallejo ivory just to get them to pop a little bit more. So that's what I'm going to do now. Just try and get that out of the way and then move on to the actual tools and accessories on here and everything else that's on here. You might notice throughout this video, I don't know how well you guys can see this or not, some of the brush highlights are actually a little stark, but that's okay because again they'll be toned down significantly once I get the washes and then the weathering and the dirt and everything else on here. So this is, it's not going to be a super dirty tank, but it's also not going to be a super clean tank. The scene I'm planning for this is actually similar to what's on the box, to the box art of Leopard in Winter. I thought the contrast on there is awesome, so that's what I'm going to try and go for. But, right now all I'm going to do is just kind of dab this lighter paint on some of these lighter areas here. Clamps sticking up, any handles sticking up, any points on here. The hole actually doesn't need as much of it. Not necessarily, this doesn't necessarily go on to the highest points per se, or on the edges rather, so I won't, you know, I won't do a edge piece with this, but it goes on the higher points so they stand out a little bit more. So like this piece here, these clamps here are all getting a little dabble. Now this won't be super visible, but just enough to make these small details pop out a little bit more. Is essentially what we're trying to do to increase contrast down here, basically, so that when you look at this it's a little bit more three-dimensional and not as two-dimensional as if I just left one color on here and called it a day. I'm gonna brighten this gray up just a little bit, gray, a little natal black really, but it's more of a gray than a black. I'm gonna brighten it up just a little bit more for the rivets here. Okay, and here we go. So I'm gonna continue doing this throughout the entire model again, nothing too crazy, just sparingly at portions that really pop out. Again, if you screw up, if you get a little too much on there, if you get a little, don't worry. As I keep saying, the wonderful thing about putting paint on is it comes off just as easily. Whether I
brush over it or weather over it. Or that's another wonderful thing of weathering armor or any kind of model, really, is it hides all manners of sin. So this is essentially in preparation for the weathering and everything else. Again, it's not going to be heavily weathered, but just enough to where it's going to look good, in my opinion, at least, but we'll see. Anyways, I'm going to continue on with this and talk to you guys when I'm ready for the tools.
Alright guys, hopefully you're seeing where I'm getting it over here with these. I'm going to end up doing the rest of this off camera. It's actually a lot easier for me when I hold it up closely or closer, and that way you guys can't see what I'm doing. So I'm going to end up doing the rest of this off camera, and then I'm also going to go ahead and undercoat all the tools and the accessories and the machine gun and everything else with black paint. And then I'll come back to you after that to show you what I'm going to do following that. So, talk to you soon. Alright guys, so what I ended up doing, or what I ended up finishing now, is all the details that are going to be painted anything other than the camo scheme. I ended up painting black, and some of them will actually remain black, such as the caps for the smoke launchers here. The MG up top is going to stay black, although I will give it a light dry brush of a light gray just to bring it out a little bit. What I finished doing is doing the edge highlights on here and everything else. So what I'm going to end up showing you guys now, sorry about that, what I'm going to end up showing you now is how I did the wheels very quickly, just so you have a better idea of how I do them without having to use any masks. Now the wheels, now hopefully you guys can see this. One second. Hopefully you can see this. So the wheels ended up staying, or I ended up painting without any masks on them. The reason I didn't do it on camera was it's just a lot easier for me to hold these closer to my body and off camera without any real way of me getting these on camera. But hopefully I can at least replicate and show you how I did these. I did them in pure black. I painted them with Vallejo black. The reason for this is I know that rubber isn't technically a deep black or isn't technically a dark black, but I wanted a bit of contrast between the NATO black on the tank camo itself and what the wheels are going to end up being. I didn't want them two of the same color, so I just opted for pure black on here. So what I ended up doing is I just put a little bit of, or I just get some black paint on my red plate over here, diluted about half water, 50-50 mix, 50% paint and 50% water. Put it on my brush, and the first thing I ended up doing on this whole thing is just going around the wheel with my brush. You can see I'm using long wooden sticks to hold on to these. There's some poster tack in here to hold the wheel in place as I'm doing this. So I ended up going around with the brush on each of these first of all, and then letting them dry, obviously doing them one at a time. Second thing I did, which was actually fairly easy because of the wheels are indented in here, obviously. So what I ended up doing was just putting some black paint on my brush like this and just spinning the wheel around like that, and it actually worked out pretty well. And I did the same thing inside here and on the back. Then finally what I did was add the little red details to the caps over here using blood red from scale 75, which again just went in with my brush and basically just painted that. So that's how I did the wheels. The wheels are finished prior to weathering, of course, so I'm going to set these aside for the time being so they don't get scruffed up. Until I'm ready to put them on. Now, my original plan was to install the wheels prior to clear coating the entire model, but I decided against it just because there's a little bit of weathering I want to do on the underside of the hull before I do that. So for the time being, I'm leaving them off. What I'm going to start on now is actually let me fill in. So you know, I'm gonna leave the antenna for last because those are gonna stay black. So a little bit of artistic license over here, call it what you will. This hose over here, which is the fire control for the grenade launchers on here, it's actually, all the reference photos I've seen at least, it's painted green. I'm going to leave it black just to give it that extra bit of contrast on here, just to kind of differentiate and give it that little extra bit of detail on here. Other than that, let's get started on the few wooden details on here. And that's going to be fairly easy and straightforward too. I'm not planning on doing anything too super complicated on here. I'm going to do it a light wood on the tool handles here, again just for that added contrast. And I see there's some paint rubbing off of the grill over here, so let me fix that real quick before we move on, because I'll forget about it otherwise. So just a little bit of NATO brown, I'll add a little bit of NATO brown on there just to get rid of that pea sticking out. And I've noticed one of my antennas already bent on here, but that's okay. I'll bend it into place when the actual model's finished. Where was it? It's right here. Rubbing off just a little bit. Let's add a little bit of NATO brown on there just to cover it up.
we're good to go. Okay. So, for the metallic parts, or I'm sorry, not the metallic parts, for the wood parts rather, I'm going to use Vallejo Khaki Gray. Again, shake it fairly well. Get into my little plate over here. It's a very bright brown. It won't stay that bright, but for the time being, that's my base color. Mix it in with some water. Now, Vallejo browns don't cover extremely well. They do cover well, obviously, but they don't cover extremely well, so I might need 3 or 4 coats on here. So let's get started on that. I'm going to position this so I'm comfortable and you guys can see what I'm doing. Does that work? Yeah, that works. Okay. So just a little paint on my brush. And just basically go over the, I don't know how well you guys can see this. But you can see the black undercoat underneath. So it's already showing through. It's going to need a few layers on here to cover completely. But, this is essentially what it is, and I'm sorry for shaking on camera like this. That's how I always shake, so. And another thing, you don't have to go all the way around the actual handle here. Just get it enough to the surface. You can leave a small black line showing even. That just adds the shadow on there. To differentiate, to give it more of that, of that 3D look, to differentiate it from the actual surface that it's sitting on. So you don't have to go all the way down. If you do screw up, if you do get some brown paint on here, obviously it's a quick fix, so no biggie. And I have to stop touching these grills because what I'm doing is messing them up with my fingers here. So the paint's chipping. I'll go over them again before I clear coat the model and prep for the wash. Now, what I hope to get done tonight is get all the details completely finished off and get it clear coated and get the first oil wash on here, which will be a pin wash to accentuate the details a little bit more on here, at which point I'm going to have to let this sit and dry for a little bit. And so I figured what I have so far, what you guys have seen so far and up to that point, will be part one of this this painting. And then I'll do a part two with the actual weathering on here once the time comes. Now the oil I'm going to have to let sit for at least a few days. Now I am going over some of the metal parts here. Don't worry about that, as I'll end up filling those in later with metallic paint. But the oil is going to have to dry for a few days for me to be comfortable to further weather it. So this is going to have to sit. Today is Saturday the 29th. So I'll probably let this sit till maybe Thursday of next week, provided I finish it all tonight. And let the oils dry for a few days, and then I'll be comfortable to go back in here and start weathering further. Now really the only parts that I'm going to paint black are these three handles here, the two spades and the pickaxe. It's the only thing that's getting the brown paint on here, and I have to keep reminding myself that there's still details back here that I'm going to have to paint as well. But I actually keep forgetting that there's the insignia back there that needs painted. But it's really, as far as the brush control goes, it's really, granted, I've been painting figures for the past, 15 years or however long I've been doing it for now. So brush control comes with time, but realistically, even if you're not comfortable to a certain degree with the brush, and you feel like you couldn't do it justice, don't be afraid to give it a try. Worst that can happen is you end up going outside of the lines, essentially, and you can just go back in and fix it with whatever paint you go over, like I'll end up doing in some places here, I'm sure. Probably another reason why I'm not a huge fan of mixing my own colors over time. Granted, there's some that I just can't get away with that I have to mix my colors, but for the most part, you'll see me using colors right out of the paint tubes. Just because it makes it so much easier and gives me the opportunity to later go back and easily fix it if there's any mistakes or if there's, you know, any, if I get any paint on there that I shouldn't get on there. Especially since I don't really have the luxury, time-wise, to sit down and then, you know, finish projects over a couple of days. Usually takes me a few weeks. So even if I leave my paint mixes in the palette, they'll dry by the time I might need them. I used to do paint mixes and then store them in my own little dropper bottles. I bought a bunch of little empty dropper bottles, clear dropper bottles on eBay. Just store them there, but it's just time consuming and a bit of a pain in the butt to mix your own paints and then store them in these little dropper bottles and everything, and then I always ended up mixing more than I needed and then just throwing the paint out because I didn't have any further use for it afterwards. So, plus, not to mention with all the different, you know, paint companies between what I use, you know, Vallejo and Scale 75, Games Workshop paints and AK paints and MIG paints, and there's so many different paint companies. Reaper paints, it's almost impossible to not find, if not the exact color, pretty darn close color to what you're looking for, so I always opt to take that route as over mixing my own paints and then either wasting them afterwards because I've mixed too much or just taking the time to do it even. And the same goes for when I paint figures. It's 90% of the paint I use is directly out of the bottle. Now granted, there's for highlighting and stuff, obviously I mix them on my palette as I'm working on it, but that can be expected. That's to be expected. So that's pretty much, I think that'll pretty much do it for me filling in the black over here, or for me filling in the brown on the tools. Over here, I don't like how this looks a little. And this is an older brush actually that I'm using right now, so it's a little frayed. Granted, I don't need a incredibly detailed brush for this, just because it's a larger model anyway, so it's not like I need something that'll hold a perfect point. Just picking up the turret over here, make sure there's no wood detail on here. Nope, okay. So that'll do it for the wood color. Now what I'm going to do is that dries almost instantly. Vallejo browns especially dry really quickly. So that's dry by now. What I'm going to do is give it a quick wash, a quick dark brown wash with, dropping stuff all over the place here. So I'm going to give it a quick wash with Army Painter Strong Tone. This is probably my most used wash on whether I'm painting models or figures. It's a really dark, rich brown, and it just, the Army Painter washes actually sit very well as far as adhering to whatever detail you're washing with them. They'll darken up whatever color you're washing with them. Quick flesh recipes that I use is this color is a big part of it, actually. Now, you don't want any pooling up on top over here for obvious reasons. And then it's just going to look sloppy if you let it pool up right on top. You kind of brush it over right into the edges over here, so the edges over here can look darker. Just so it gives it that extra contrast to it. But don't let it pool up right in the middle, as again, that'll just make it look sloppy and rushed, basically. So again, same goes for here. And I use this wash a lot for this particular wash color. Army Painter Strong Tone, I use it a lot for, again, skin tone, although lately I've been moving away from it for when I do, you know, a little bit more more time intensive skin tones. I stay away from the washes and I just use paints directly. I've been using the Scale 75 paints lately for my skin color on all my figures and staying away from the washes. But for a quick skin tone, and that's maybe a tutorial I'll do in the future if anybody's interested, but for the time being, anyways, that's also going to dry very quickly. So it just, I hope you guys can see this, it just darkens the initial color down a little bit. It shades it down a little bit as well. It gives it the more 3D look, I guess, for lack of a better word. That's done. We'll also be using washes and all sorts of different weathering techniques on here, so that'll also blend in a little bit more. But the next parts I'm going to paint is the metallics, which is the space tool back here, the tool over here, the toe chain, and the tracks. All are going to get a coat of metallic paint on them, and then I'll show you how I weather those, or how I weather those in, I guess. Also using mostly washes, acrylic washes on here. Metallic of choice for me is gunmetal from Vallejo Game Color. I know there's better ones out there. Scale 75 does much better metallics. I haven't tried any of the acrylic paints that are geared for or advertised for model painting, as in MIG or AK or any of that. Just because I've never really had any issues with the gunmetal from Vallejo, so I just continue to use that and I've been very happy with it. But again, 50% paint to 50% water. That's pretty much my go-to paint mix ratio for most of my paint that I mix. A few exceptions, but it's 50-50 is usually what I do. There's people who will water paint down, you know, 1% paint to 25% water or whatever. Or I'm sorry, or one part paint to 25 parts water or whatever, to, you know, almost translucent consistency. That's just not how I paint, so I don't do that. Basically, what you're looking for out of your paint for brush painting, at least, and the same can be said for airbrush painting, is a consistency of milk on your paint, and don't be afraid if it's too transparent. You can always go back and apply a second or third coat if necessary. But this way, it keeps the paint thin enough where it gives you much better control of it. And it also doesn't clog up any details, or it doesn't dry too fast and just give it that thick look that paint, you know, if you use paint that's too thick, you can tell when you look at it, it's just too thick and too not watered down enough. Anyways, what I'm going to do is do these metallic parts here, and I'll come back to you guys and show you how I shade them. Alright guys, the metallics are base coated now. What I ended up doing is, again, on the turret, it's a real quick review. Grenade launchers, two little springs back here. And I did end up painting the ammo gold into the feeding into the MG here. On the hull itself, the tow cable, the spades, the pick, whatever tool this is, and the tracks over here. What you will notice and what you might be saying to yourself is, wow, this looks horrible. It's very shiny, it's very bright, and I couldn't agree with you more. So what we're going to do now is make it look a little better. A little less shiny tone. Oops, excuse me. Tone it down a little bit. Again, what I ended up using for the metallics is Vallejo Game Color Gunmetal. And for the gold, I used Vallejo Game Color Glorious Gold. Now, to tone this down, I am going to use another Army Painter wash, this time dark tone. This is basically a black wash. They call them inks. Call them what you will. Put a little bit on my plate here and go to town on this. Now, I do water these down a little bit just because I don't want them setting too much. So again, about 50% ink to 50% water. Now, once I'm done with the quick ink washes on here, what I am going to do is change out the water from my water glass, from my brush that I used to clean my brush in, just because it is now contaminated with the metallics, and believe you me, metallics will stick, the metallic flakes, the actual aluminum flakes that are in the paint, they will stick to everything and anything. So I'm going to clean that up as soon as I am done with this wash here. And be sure to clean your brushes. If you use the same brush for metallic painting as you do everything else, and you can tell I am, just make sure you clean your brush thoroughly in between using the different paints. And you clean your water thoroughly as well, because again, as I said, it'll stick to everything. Again, now going back to some of these metallic areas here, for instance, these springs in the hatch, I'm almost 100% sure that that's not accurate as far as the color on the actual tank. I'm pretty sure those springs are kept black. That said, I did want to add a little bit of tonal variation on there, a little bit more contrast, so that's why I chose to do them in the metallic color. Again, I mean, I like to keep as authentic as possible, but at the same time, I will take whatever looks aesthetically better with as far as contrast and as far as enhancing the overall look over realism. So I will definitely take a few liberties here and there just to make, in my opinion at least, obviously, and then some of you guys may hate it, but in my opinion, make the details pop a little bit more and just make it look a little better. So now for the hull here, just quick wash. You don't have to be too particular about this. The paint actually flows pretty well. The ink flows pretty well, call it what you will. Over all the parts here, you don't have to be that clean about it, because even if you do get it where it doesn't belong, like I just did on the camo over here, number one, I'll take my brush real quick and just wipe it off. Number two, it will just look like shadow coming off from whatever object you're actually using it on. So you don't have to be too fussy about it. Granted, don't be too careless either. Obviously, there's a happy medium for everything, and then that's what you want to kind of try for, is be liberal with it, but don't be careless, essentially. Just the chain here. Again, a decent amount of wash on here, so I don't have to go back too many times over. And also, what I did was go through, as I was painting the metallics on here, go through some of the
some of the camo needed touching up on various parts and etc. So I ended up doing that as well while it was fresh in my mind as I saw it. I don't want to forget about it. But other than that, this is pretty much it for the first coat here on the silver. I'm going to let that dry. Let that set. Now for the gold, I'm going to use some more strong tone that you've seen me use before. That we used on the wood grain or on the wood for the tools. I'm not sure how well you can see the tools actually dried now. And here you can't see at all. That's not what you can see, you can't see at all. There we go. Tools are actually dry on here now. Hopefully you can tell that they've darkened significantly and actually have a nice shade on them. So for the gold, I'm going to do a fairly heavy coat of the dark tone, let that set, and then I'll go over with a lighter tone of purple. Now I'm also going over the metallic areas with the dark tone. Not even necessarily to replicate rust or anything of that sort, but to give it maybe that grimy, oily look to it, and also to tone the metallics down even further a little bit. Now don't overdo it on here, because then it will end up looking rusty, and I'm also not going for that. This tank will not be, it's not an old tank obviously, and it's not going to be beat up by any means. So just kind of sparingly, and you know, if you apply too much wash on one part, then it's just a matter of picking it back up with your brush and spreading it across another part. But this is basically what I'm going for. Here, once it's dry, you'll be able to see that a little better. It'll be less shiny. Two primary purposes to this is, number one, it gives it a little bit more... Oh, I forgot this part here on the spade. Darn it. So if I want it metallic, I really don't. I have to go back in there and fix that. But number one, the metallics in general are very, very bright colors, and then I don't necessarily like how shiny they are. And I'm sure there's plenty of better paints for this purpose, possibly, and even better methods of doing it, but this is just how I taught myself from painting figures, so it works for me on figures, and I've kind of transitioned it with it to models. Essentially, they're very bright, the metallic paints are very shiny. I'm not a huge fan of that, so that's why I apply these ink washes to them, just to give them, number one, to tone them down, number two, to give them a little bit more variation, that shadow. A little bit more shadow, and then, you know, make them pop, or not pop a little bit more, make them pop a lot less, actually. So that's why I do what I do with the various colors on here. The brown, again, it's not even for rust, but more for grime and you know, dirt, or and to tone it down further. The brown actually does a much better job of toning the paint down. The black is primarily for the shadows. Well, the brown is what really tones down the sheen on the metallic paint, where it still looks metallic, obviously, but it's not nearly as shiny as it would have been otherwise, and I like that. I'm not a big fan of making it too shiny, for multiple reasons. I mean, number one, this is the tanks, you know, they're not going to have anything shiny on them. Number two, I just think it doesn't look neat. I'm a big proponent of making my paint jobs look as neat as possible, I guess, to the best of my abilities at least, so it doesn't look neat. And number three, it doesn't, if I left it as shiny as it comes out of the bottle originally, I think it would attract or catch the eye a little bit too much, maybe. At which point, it would be distracting from all the other detail and from everything else I want you guys to look at on this, as opposed to just, it would draw the eye too much to the metallic parts themselves, as opposed to it just being another detail on here as it is. So,
and using this dark brown on here avoids this looking rusty. It gives it that grime color. If I wanted rust, I'd go for a more orange, more center, more localized orange oxide color than I would with a dark brown. I completely forgot about the track in the front. Or tracks in the front, so I'm going to go through those. I got them with the black.
So I'm just going to hit them with the brown here shortly.
We're going to hit them with the brown now. It's not, the black isn't completely dry, but that's okay, it doesn't need to be. Now for the pads on the track.
As you can see there, you can see some back here, so I'm going to go in there and paint those. I'll paint these black just because they're not that visible, so it's just in case somebody looks in there for them to be visible enough to see that they're painted. But for the actual pads on the tracks, the rubber pads, I was thinking about doing them black originally, but I feel like that would tie or clash too much, or would make it look too dull because the wheels are already all black. Then I thought NATO black again. I don't want to use the same color that I used on the camo again. That's just too much of the same. So I think I'm actually going to do a 50-50 mix of black and NATO black and paint the track pads that way, but I'll only do that to the ones on the actual tracks themselves. Again, these here on the hull, they're just not visible enough to really warrant any sort of time commitment like that to mixing the paint. As you can see, you can only see, the very edge of that, so let me get that out of the way now and just hit it with some black paint and call it a day. Other than that, I think I'm ready to say that the major tools and components and details are done on this sort of getting closer to being able to spray this down with some gloss coat and get it ready for the decals and get it ready for the first oil wash, which will be a pin wash. There we go, I got the track pads done. Say that three times fast. Track pads, yeah. This is drying, this is looking decent. Again, even if something at this point doesn't look 100% to you, or if you've gotten this far and you're going, wow, this kind of looks like crap, don't fret too much, just because there's going to be a lot of weathering happening on here. There's going to be a lot of washes going on here, a lot of oil paints, a lot of everything. So this is still what I want to call the base coat on everything. You're getting the details done and you're getting them finished up, but for the most part, this is still just the base coat. There's still a lot more that's going to go on here. So don't get too bummed out if it's not looking the way you're expecting it to look just yet. I almost forgot about the ammo. Throw some purple on there. Apologize for my chair squeaking, but nothing I can do about that. Throw some purple on the ammo again. Army paint or purple tone.
water it down, 50% water, 50%.
Actually, this is more of a 75% water, 25% ink, and you don't want to do it too heavily, like that's too much that I just put on there. So I'm going to clean my brush out and just take some of that away. You just want the slightest hint of purple on there. Unless you're doing something that's been exposed to higher temperatures already, that's obviously, you know, bronze or copper is going to turn purple once it's been exposed to higher temperatures. Okay, the only two things left now, or not the only two things left, but the two main things left is the MG and all the viewport screens and everything else, and we'll talk about those in a second. Let me go change my water out, and I'll be back to do the MG real quick. Okay, so one thing I did forget on here, and I changed my water out already, are the barrel rods right in here, which my understanding at least are metallic, but I think these actually get painted before they're issued to the tank or on the tank. So what I'm going to do is paint them a mid-tone gray.
Let's see what I can pull out over here, maybe. One second here, guys.
Be a rainy gray from scale 75. I think that's what I'll end up using. It's a sort of closer to a concrete gray, really. I think that'll do well with a black wash over it afterwards. So I'm just going to give this a good shake. Yeah, I think that'll work. It's not that big of a surface, and the wash, I'm going to make sure that's a little bit heavier than normal, so they're almost black, but pop out enough to the point where you can still see the gray through it. So that is one point that I completely forgot on here, and believe me, I do that quite often. I forget quite a bit on these models. I then actually have to go back and repaint. So sorry if you guys can't really see this on camera. Try and get it done as quickly and efficiently as possible so I can move on to the MG. And then the various screens and viewports. And then we will be calling it done for... I'm just going to start calling this a base coat or base on the model. And we'll be ready for the... gloss coat and then decals and the pin wash, first pin wash, which is going to be first of many washes and many different combinations of using oils for different things. Another reason I'm using this gray on here, it's really not even a concrete gray, it's more of a bit of red to it. Red hinge gray, not something I would normally go for. It's not a brilliant color by any means, but at the same time, I think it'll give it a nice variation to just kind of look at this and say, oh, here's something else. You know, it kind of breaks up the monotony of the camouflage, since so much on this tank is just whatever the camouflage color is. I think it's a nice little way to break that up. And again, when I add the black wash to this, it'll make it a little bit less, it'll make it pop a little bit less to where it's not staring you right in the face and you're going, oh, that looks out of place. So it'll kind of blend it all together a little bit, or blend it in a little bit to the rest of the tank. But still give it enough of that tonal variation to where it breaks up the monotony on the camo. So I'm going to have to go back over this camo afterwards and fix some of it, because I am just way, way all over this place trying to rush this. But that's okay. Again, I should have paid closer attention to the instructions to what they were telling me. And again, another thing is, as I was looking through the painting guide and the instructions, and to be honest with you, I don't even know how correct that is to the actual thing, but I would guess it's at least somewhat accurate. I was looking through that, and for instance, the spades on the back of the tank are actually an olive drab color. Not the metallic that I chose to paint, and there's a few details that I found that are a little different, but you know what? That's okay. Again, the pick is also complete olive drab, according to the instructions at least. But that's okay. Again, I'm happy with my color choices, at least, on it. It's not 100% accurate, and again, I don't know how accurate the instructions are, but if they are, then it's not 100% accurate to the real thing, but you know what, that's okay. Because I feel like it looks good anyways, so yeah, better than it would with an olive drab, or, you know, with another coat of NATO green, or whatever else, so I'm okay with that not looking 100%. Okay, that's as covered as it'll have to be, or as it has to be. Take some NATO black here, fix up some of the camo areas I just screwed up, and I just messed up. But this is essentially what it's going to end up looking like, and I think, again, nice variation once I get that wash in there. It'll look even better. Because it'll give it that tonal depth to it. Again, I'm gonna use a dark tone in there. Water it down about 50-50. These inks are meant to use right out of the bottle, but they actually tend to be very, very heavy. Now, if any of you guys are familiar with figure painting, or have done figure painting, or do figure painting, Games Workshop used to make a line of washes that they discontinued a couple of years ago, and these Army Painter washes are very, very similar to what Games Workshop used to make. That's why I ended up getting them, because I liked the Games Workshop ones so much until they discontinued them. And yeah, these are very good washes, but they do tend on to go, or they tend to go on quite heavily. So you're better off diluting them with water from the get-go, and then just, you know, applying two or three coats if you're not happy with the first one. But I find that a 50-50 mix is ideal, and one coat is usually more than enough. And just kind of spread this out into the crevices here, into the recesses between the rods. Just enough to give it that tonal variation. Keep saying that, you know, you guys should play a drinking game at home. See how many times, every time I say tonal variation, you drink. You also find that I say contrast a lot. This is what that looks like so far without the ink being dry, obviously. Okay, so next up, what we have left is the MG and all the viewports. Now, the MG, I was originally going to paint meticulously with, you know, highlight it with grays, and then, you know, bring up the highlights and etc. But then I figured out I didn't really want to put myself through all that. So I'm just going to give it a very, very, very light dry brush of gray. So this is, I still have some NATO black left on here, which is essentially gray. I'm gonna mix that with 50-50 ivory, Vallejo ivory. There's no need to dilute this because this is going to be a dry brush, so actually the thicker the paint the better because it dries faster. Now we can see how light this is. So what I want to do is make sure I get as much of this off my brush as possible. This is a very thick, very rough brush, so I want to be very, very gentle on here as I go over this thing. And again, the purpose of this is just to hit it on the very tips of the edges, just pop it out a little bit more. Now, I'm not sure if the if the stock back here actually stays black, or if it's a wooden stock. I would imagine it stays black. I would imagine it's plastic. And I'm not too sure, but I'm going to keep it black. So
hopefully you guys saw that. Yeah, you did. Okay, so this is what this. That's pretty much all I'm doing to this. Is just very, very lightly, gently going over this with a dry brush of a very light gray. And that's as far as I'm going to take this. All the tips are popping, but it still looks black. So that's what I'm going for over here. I don't want to get rid of
it. I don't want it to look gray. I want it to look black, but just stand out a little bit more as you look at it. So that's done. Now we're going to work on the viewports. So there are... Sorry, you guys, hold on, let me pick my paints up for this. There are a lot of viewports on here. A lot of, between the commander's hatch right here, between the, I think this is the gunner's sight, between the commander's periscope here. Oops, sorry, let me zoom you back out a little bit. Not in, out. A little bit more, there you go. Between all the screens on here, and this is just the turret, the hull has quite a few as well, including lights. The lights we'll get to afterwards. Let me do all the screens first, and all the hatches and all the viewports and stuff. Now this, there's quite a bit of it. Now, I had the option of masking this. Had the option of masking this before I started doing it, and then basically going the route of unmasking it after I'm done with the painting, since most of these were clear parts, or all of these were clear parts actually, unmasking it after I was done with the painting, and then giving it just a very light wash of whatever color I wanted it to look like, but the clear part would obviously be translucent and it would make it look like what it's supposed to be, which is a screen. Now, there's two reasons I didn't do that. Reason number one being I was lazy, and by the time I figured it out, I was already looking forward and setting my mind on painting, so I said, screw it, I'm just gonna paint them. Number two, which is maybe the more real reason, is I actually wanted to paint them as opposed to masking and then washing them whatever color I wanted to wash them. Why? Well, as realistic, sorry, I'm shaking paint right now that I'm going to base this with, so if I sound a little crackly, I'm sorry. As realistic as I want this thing to look, there's still a certain, and this is just my paint style, obviously. This is, a lot of, for most scale modelers, I would say, paint for realism, obviously, and so do I. Try to get a certain amount of realism into this. But my paint style from my, I started with figures and then transitioned into models after many, many years, is a lot more cartoonish. There's a lot more... I like to show a lot more contrast in my painting than you'd normally see, especially on scale model kits. Now, painting these viewports enables me to do that. Granted, they're not going to look super realistic. They will look cartoony and probably will look painted, and you'll go, what the hell? But at the same time, I feel like that gives me much better contrast, much more contrast. And it pops more. It makes the tank, it makes it more eye-catching. It makes the tank more eye-catching in general, whether it looks realistic or not. Oh, well, I'm not really going for realism here at this point with the viewport. So what I'll be using is Cantabric Blue from Scale 75 to base all of these with. And I was also playing with the idea of using red to base coat all of these and doing a red thing, although I know that wouldn't be accurate. I thought it might look a little bit more badass, but I quickly changed my mind due to the fact that there's going to be quite a few red details on here already. Between the caution decals on the back of the tank, the lights on the stoplights on the back of the tank, the wheel hubs are red. I just wanted to introduce another contrasting color in here, just to give it a little bit more oomph. So this is basically what I'm doing now, is just base coating these with, it's a dark blue. See how that goes. See how that turns out. So what I did when I was filling in all the black details, I did go ahead and fill all the viewports in with the black, just so I have a fresh base to start from on here. Coverage does not need to be perfect 100% because this is... Sorry if I'm off camera. First of all, this paint does cover pretty well, so I'm only using one layer for the most part as I go through, but it does not need to be perfect because there's going to be quite a bit of blending that we're going to be doing to this, and quite a bit of, well, not quite a bit of, but we will be using some washes on this just to tone down that blending afterwards a little bit so it looks a little bit more convincing. So this blue coverage does not need to be 100% perfect. Granted, get it as close as you can, but use your own judgment as to how far you actually want to go with it. What I'm going to do now, guys, is do this off camera because I'm just realizing how much easier that's going to be for me. So I'm going to do that off camera, and I will come right back to you when it's all set. All right, guys, I am all done on the vision ports and on the screens and monitors as far as the base coating goes. Okay, this is what it looks like, and it does look a little sloppy right now. Only because, as I said, this is a first quick coat. So, here's the tank. Hopefully you guys can see that. What I'm going to do now is, I was using, for the base coat again, I was using Cantabric Blue from Scale 75. I am now going to use Sky Blue for the highlights. Now, so this is what I'm going to end up doing. I still have some of the Cantabric Blue left on my plate here. So I'm going to add a tiny amount, I want to say less than a drop of the Sky Blue into the Cantabric. Add a good amount of water. Again, one part water, one part paint, 50-50 essentially. Mix it all together. And then on top of that, what I want to do is add a drop. Now I have to mix this paint a little bit more because it's not right where I want it to be. It was a little separated in that one. I'm going to add some glaze medium, a drop of glaze medium into this mixture as well. Number one, it's going to... actually, two drops. It's going to keep the paint from drying for a little bit longer. And number two, most importantly, it'll help with the transitions and the actual parts that I'm painting here, with it being a little smoother because it'll be a little bit more opaque. So, hold on one second.
before I get started. Excuse me. Make sure I didn't miss anything here. Which I didn't by the looks of it. Got that. Sorry, looking at the instructions real quick. Yep, good to go. Okay. So, what I'm going to do is take a tiny amount of that mixture onto my brush. I mean, a tiny, tiny amount. Oops, wrong way. Okay. And this screen, for instance, whoops. Start out in the middle and just go right across here and fill in the top half, or not the top half rather, but the diagonally fill in one half of whatever you're painting. So I'm going to repeat that to all these screens here. And again, this doesn't have to be perfectly smooth, because there will be so many more coats going on here that if it's not perfect, it won't matter too much, because this is basically every coat is an underlying coat for the next. Let me get the hole out of the way so I can rest my elbows a little easier on the table here. Focus here for you guys. The screens down here, actually, I'm gonna use the same method here, but I'm gonna do it more in the middle, just because that'll pop better as opposed to it being either top or bottom, because of how covered they are up here. So there's one more in here, just a little bit. Again, it doesn't have to be perfect. I already got some blue on the natal black over here. If that's okay, we'll go back over and fix that later. And I'm going to do the same with this screen. Again, more in the towards the middle than a halfway through kind of deal, because of the shape and position of these. Essentially, they'll look more like they're reflecting light. They'll look more like they're glowing and reflecting light. Like they're glass or plastic or whatever. Whatever they're made of, but they need to look like they're opaque and not solid blue, essentially. So that's what we're trying for over here. This screen right here, I know, is going to be covered up. This screen right here, I know it's going to be covered up with a decal. I haven't actually taken that close of a look at the decal sheet, so I don't know whether it's a solid decal or whether it's an opaque decal or what it is, so I'm painting it as if it was, and I think the screen in here is also covered up. This screen in here also gets covered up, I believe, with another decal, but again, I haven't taken that close of a look, so whether it is or isn't, I'm painting it as if it wasn't, and if it does, oh well. Not that big of a deal. So I've got the first coat on here. And get the first coat on here, and again, I'm going to repeat this maybe 10 times. Each time adding a tiny amount of sky blue into my original mix. I'll repeat about 10 times each time, covering a smaller and smaller area so it looks more like the light is reflecting and bouncing off of the screens. At the very end, I think I'll add white dots into the centers here somewhere. But I'll come back to that. Let me do this off camera real quick again, maybe 9 or 10 coats of this, just smaller and smaller areas every time. And I'll get back before I finish it off completely to show you guys how to finish it off. But let me do this off camera so I can bring it closer to my body and make it a little bit easier on myself. So I'll be back in a minute. Alright guys, so I finished off the blue. It took about 12 layers each time, adding a little bit more every time. A little bit more sky blue every time. It'd be nice if I could talk right now. Hopefully this is in focus. So this is what I ended up with on most of the screens here, or most of the
viewports and such. What I ended up doing was adding a dot of pure white into the middles here, or into the brightest parts here on all the on all the ports. Now here what I ended up doing, since this area back here is more in shadow, so I went with the highlight on the corner here, and then on this I went with more of a middle highlight just to make it look a little bit more convincing, which I hope I succeeded in. And that's just the paint version. Now what I'm going to do is tone it down just a little bit, blend in these highlights a little bit more. What I'm going to do is use Citadel or Games Workshop shade, Drakenhof Nightshade. This is a blue wash, essentially. Again, this is something you want to water down. These actually go on very, very heavily. What these are is these don't go into crevices or corners or everything. They'll settle on everything, and they do go on very, very heavily. So if you do end up using this, be careful. I use this maybe one part paint to about 5 parts water. Now remember, all I'm trying to do here is just make sure that I get, or that I blend these lines in a little bit, no more than that. So you just have to make sure that you don't obstruct any of the detail here on this. And again, it does go on very heavily, so in this instance, less is definitely more. All this does is just blends it in a little bit, just enough to make it look that much more convincing. Again, it's not going to be perfect. Obviously, I'm not skilled enough, nor am I willing to devote that kind of time into making these into perfect blends on something that's essentially, 3% of the entire model. It looks good from where it is. It looks convincing from where it is, and I'm happy with that. It doesn't have to look perfect. It just has to look good, and I feel like it does look good. Although it may not look perfect, it looks good. So I'm happy with the way that turned out. Now there's a few things on the turret. It's a little too much. There's a few things on the turret that I'd like to go back over with some NATO gray here. Oh, this dries. I can't forget this little guy. These antennas, I gotta tell you, I never learn. I always install the antennas during assembly, and I always pop one off one way or another. So far, I've been lucky enough to where I haven't broken any of these two off, but that's coming shortly, I'm sure. I've nudged them so many times now. My NATO black. There's a couple of things up here that I have to go over with NATO black that I've noticed that I've missed. The actual base coat, not to mention I got a nice blue splotch over here that I have to fix, so yeah, no big deal. That's another reason I do all the details before I get into any sort of shading or any sort of real highlighting or basically before I bust the oils out. In other words, because it makes it so much easier to then go back and fix the base coat if I get any unintended paint on it than it would be if I was doing this after shading and after washing and after weathering, etc. So it just makes life a lot easier on myself. Other than that, I think, that's one more in here. What I'm going to move on to now are the headlights, the stoplights, and whatever these little lights here are. I'm not sure what those lights are, but whatever they are, I'm going to move on to those next. And I gotta tell you, we're getting closer and closer to being able to say that we're ready to get some get some gloss varnish on here because we're getting much closer to it. And I like that because that's when the real fun begins, is once I start putting the oils on here, once I start the actual weathering process on here, I think that's what really brings these tanks to life. Not to say that everything we've done here was for nothing, because again, making the edges pop on here with the edge highlights and everything else, I think that's a huge part of it, of bringing this thing to life, obviously, but the highlighting, or not the highlighting, the weathering is definitely what seals the deal. Obviously, now, I know that this photo etch down here is starting to chip in places as well. Anytime you're working with a kit that has, you know, this doesn't have very much photo edge, but it has very, one second, guys. Sorry about that. One thing when working with a kit that has this much photo etch on, and it's not very much, but it's very brittle, fragile photo etch on this, is you're bound to chip some paint off of it, because again, the paint will chip much easier off of the photo etch before. Once we clear coat this, it won't be a big deal. Once we gloss varnish this, it won't be a big deal. But for the time being, I'm just going to keep going over it. Even if I miss a spot and I varnish this and it's all done, I can always chalk that up to battle damage or to chipping of some sort, and then go over it with whatever I use for the chipping when I end up chipping this thing, which is probably going to be a dark brown on it. Okay, so that's done. What's left? Headlights, stoplights, and the little crest on the back over here. I'm going to do that off camera because this video has gone way, 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 way too long already. I apologize for that, and if you're still with me, thank you. I appreciate it. I really do. I'm going to do that off camera and then come back to you guys once it's done. Looking at the instructions, it looks like it's going to be the two running lights in front and then some stoplights and some turn signals in the back. So I'm basically going to use the same method that I used on the ports, on the vision ports and on the screens, where I'm just going to go in with a darker, I'm going to start out with a darker color, going lighter, 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 and then that should make it look good. Also, once this model is completely finished, I always cover all my models at the very end with a dull coat for the protection. But I will then go back over all the screens and lights and stuff and give it a nice gloss coat so that they look even more convincing that way. But let me do the lights real quick and then I'll come back. We'll wrap that up. We'll gloss coat it and then we'll get to the decals and the pin light and the pin wash. And then we'll be done with this video. So I'm going to try and hurry this along. And I know it's been a while. It's been long. So I'll try to be as fast as possible now just to get it wrapped up. Alright guys, the lights are all done. Now what I'm going to do is very quickly go over what I did over here before I get into the finishing up before the gloss coat. So, backlights were fairly easy, fairly straightforward. What I ended up doing is using the red. I used scale 75 Aldebaran red. And then after a nice coat of that, I ended up using scale 75 Intense red. It's an ink. Be careful, these are also very highly pigmented, so I watered that down about 5 parts water to 1 part ink. And I went over the lights. Same goes with the orange. I used scale 75 Mars orange on that, and the turn signals, and very, 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 very watered down Intense yellow later on to give it just a bit of that pop over here. And then I also ended up filling in the insignia. The doing the white insignia back here, the unit insignia. Okay, so that's that for the white, or for the front lights, for the headlights. Not sure how you guys can see these, hopefully well enough. I based it with white. Took about 10 coats to get a nice nice even base. Then I went over with Citadel or Games Workshop shade, Cassandra Yellow. Okay, this gave it a nice little yellow sheen to kind of look like it's emitting light. Then again, I went back with the white towards the tops to make it seem like it's shining more on the tops. And then at the very, very bottom, a very thin line of Army Painter Strong Tone ink. And that was pretty much it. That's all she wrote on that. I'm happy with how they came out. So far, so good. Just remember, there's a couple of small details left that I still have to fill in on here. Which will be yellow. Yep. The only thing I have to fill in, I have left, are these little points here on the side of the hull. They're painted yellow, so I'm going to do that real quick. Then what I'm going to end up doing, and I'll do all this off camera, as I said, this is taking way longer than I thought it would, so I'm going to end up doing all this off camera now. We have two cats, and they leave their fur all over the place, as you may or may not have noticed. I'm sure there were a couple of pieces of fur on here at one point or another. Also dust and other particles. So before I actually clear coat this, I'm going to take a soft brush with clean water, damp the brush, and just go over the entire model, hopefully picking up any foreign particles, any dust or any fur or anything really I can get off, just to clean it up before I clear coat this, before I gloss coat it. Now what I use for my gloss coat is, if I can find it, it's Vallejo gloss varnish, essentially airbrush gloss varnish. What I'm going to do is airbrush that over. I thin that down, one part varnish to one part water, usually, or airbrush thinner actually in this case. I'll airbrush that on, I'll let that dry for a little bit, for about half an hour or so, and I'll come back real quick to do the pin wash, show you guys how I'm going to do the pin wash. I'll probably do a small section on the turret or maybe a small section on the hull on camera, finish up the video, finish up the rest, and then let that stand and dry. But let me finish off the little details off camera here real quick, do my little cleanup, do my final round, go around, make sure everything's where it's supposed to be, and then go from there. Alright guys, the lights are all done. Now what I'm going to do is very quickly go over what I did over here before I get into the finishing up before the glass coat. So, backlights were fairly easy, fairly straightforward. What I ended up doing is using the red. I used scale 75 Aldebaran red. And then after a nice coat of that, I ended up using scale 75 Intense Red. It's an ink. Be careful, these are also very highly pigmented, so I watered that down about 5 parts water to 1 part ink. And I went over the lights. Same goes with the orange. I used scale 75 Mars Orange on that, and the turn signals. And very, 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 very watered down Intense Yellow later on to give it just a bit of that pop over here. And then I also ended up filling in the insignia. The doing the white insignia back here, the unit insignia. Okay, so that's that for the white, or for the front lights, for the headlights. Not sure how you guys can see these, hopefully well enough. I based it with white. Took about 10 coats to get a nice even base. Then I went over with Citadel or Games Workshop shade, Cassandra Yellow. Okay, this gave it a nice little yellow sheen to kind of look like it's emitting light. Then again, I went back with the white towards the tops to make it seem like it's shining more on the tops. And then at the very, very bottom, a very thin line of Army Painter Strong Tone ink. And that was pretty much it. That's all she wrote on that. I'm happy with how they came out. So far, so good. Just remember, there's a couple of small details left that I still have to fill in on here. Which will be yellow. Yep. The only thing I have to fill in, I have left, are these little points here on the side of the hull. They're painted yellow, so I'm going to do that real quick. Then what I'm going to end up doing, and I'll do all this off camera, as I said, this is taking way longer than I thought it would, so I'm going to end up doing all this off camera now. We have two cats, and they leave their fur all over the place. As you may or may not have noticed, I'm sure there were a couple of pictures, a couple of pieces of fur on here at one point or another. Also dust and then other particles. So before I actually clear coat this, I'm going to take a soft brush with clean water, damp the brush, and just go over the entire model, hopefully picking up any foreign particles, any dust or any fur or anything really I can get off, just to clean it up before I clear coat this, before I gloss coat it. Now what I use for my gloss coat is, if I can find it, it's Vallejo gloss varnish, essentially airbrush gloss varnish. What I'm going to do is airbrush that over. I thin that down, one part varnish to one part water, usually, or airbrush thinner actually in this case. I'll airbrush that on, I'll let that dry for a little bit, for about half an hour or so, and I'll come back real quick to do the pin wash, show you guys how I'm going to do the pin wash. I'll probably do a small section on the turret or maybe a small section on the hull on camera, finish up the video, finish up the rest, and then let that stand and dry. But let me finish off the little details off camera here real quick, do my little cleanup, do my final round, go around, make sure everything's where it's supposed to be, and then go from there. Okay guys, definitely starting to get there now. I went ahead and clear coat or gloss coated the model, and then I also went ahead and applied the decals. I'm getting ready to do the first pin wash, the first pin oil wash, just very quickly. I don't do anything special when I apply decals at all. Once I clear coat or gloss coated the model, I then went ahead and areas where the decals were going, such as here, I put another coat of, I brushed on another coat of gloss varnish just to make sure the surface was extra slippery. I put the decal on, waited for it to dry, and then covered it with another coat of gloss varnish, and then pretty much there's no silvering or anything of that sort on here. Same with the decals back here. Everything went on pretty smoothly. Other than that, what I'm going to do is just show you guys really quick of how I start the pin wash, and I'm going to sit down and actually do it, and then come back to you once it's done to show you the results, and then let it dry for a couple of days. So what I use for my oil washes is Winsor & Newton paints, oil paints, and I thin them down with some good old regular turpentine. This is basically the consistency of my wash here. I am going to continue to use my Winsor & Newton Series 7 brush on this, only because I completely intend on throwing this out after this project's over. It's an old brush, it's already starting to fray, so it's going to go in the trash anyways. So let's get going on this. Basically just pin washing along any and all details here. Just like this. You do have to be careful. These edges all are textured, all bevel, or not beveled, but all textured edges, or not edges, but surfaces are all textured over here, so you do have to be careful. And this is a very light pin wash for the time being, and again, it's only going to go around the most pronounced details so that they pop out a little bit more. Other than that, once this is done, again, I don't think you'll be able to see much of a difference at this point, actually. You know, I might not come back once I'm done with this, because I don't think you guys are going to notice a difference at all once this is done. Not until the oil dries and the gloss varnish is toned down a little bit. So anyways, I'm going to continue on doing this. Hoping to get this done tonight. Again, thank you very much for bearing with me. I realize that these videos, or this video in particular, is much longer than I planned on it being. hopefully you guys are enjoying it so far, and please let me know if you know, if you'd like to see any changes or any suggestions or anything. If you do like what you're watching, please subscribe, like the video, and part two I should have out probably sometime next week with me trying to finish off the weathering, working on the base and the tracks. I also did, just a side note, I did install the wheels on here also, just to make everything easier at this point. But yeah, I appreciate you guys watching. Thank you very much. And again, like and subscribe. And see you in the next video.